When we moved to Texas a few years ago, one of the first things people taught us is that you needed to water your house. We didn't believe that at first. We thought for some period of time that it might be a statewide joke that everybody was in on, kind of like snipe hunting. And then people began to explain the way houses here in North Texas are built, and it more in line with building a boat than a normal foundation. You actually take this slab of concrete, you put it on top of the dirt so it will float on top of the dirt. And if the moisture gets out of whack around and under that, and part of the soil expands a lot on one side and part doesn't expand because it's dry on the other, the foundation of the house will actually twist. And that is a motion you don't ever want to see an engineer make when he's talking about your house, when he says it'll twist, because bad things happen when the foundation twists. We were in denial for a while 5 years ago when that big drought hit, and it lasted a year and a half, and we were watering the foundation, but I don't think I took it as seriously as I should. And one day, a friend was over, and he noticed in the kitchen that the gap between the wall and the ceiling was an inch, and in one of the bedrooms, about an inch and a half. And I assured him that I could cover that with crown mold, and if you nail it to the ceiling, it'll go up and down, and it'll be fine. And he said, "Steve, you're in trouble." And we didn't know we were in trouble yet. But sure enough, we hired those people to come out. The ones who guarantee their work, we don't guarantee it when we build the house. You have to hire somebody later to, right? New foundation repair, lifetime guarantee. Then why didn't you build it that way? Anyway, we hired one of those folks to come out and put in piers and dig down into something more solid and shore up our twisting foundation and bring strength back to it. The Apostle Paul had not been to the city of Rome, but he had met a number of Romans, and he knew their reputation as this cosmopolitan city, and he knew that many of them had Jesus in common among the Christians, but their foundation was out of whack. There were cracks showing. There was some twisting in their understanding of the gospel, and sometimes they may have looked a little more like a Roman eagle than the Church of Jesus. And so he writes to them probably around 57 A.D., probably from the city of Corinth, before he goes to Jerusalem. And he writes to them to help put the foundation in place. He actually will pull apart what maybe they thought the foundation was and spread out the pieces and then begin to show them how the whole house is built up, how this thing fits together, what role Jesus may play in it, and who's going to do the work of holding the parts together, because they were confused in some of their understanding. And that may be true for you this morning as you sit here. You know part of this story. You think you've got the Jesus part down. You're really not sure how the pieces fit together. Or maybe you've never really put the foundation in place and you're really not sure exactly what it is you're looking for, or whether or not this would be the place that you'd find it. In Romans chapter 1, verse 14, Paul says, "I'm under obligation both to Greeks and barbarians, to the wise and the foolish, so I'm eager to preach the gospel to you also who are at Rome." I think that's fascinating because I read it and I know from a few verses ahead that he's writing to Christians, and yet he tells them that the thing he's eager to preach to them is the gospel, because I would think that they're Christians. Don't they already know that part? And that may be exactly where we are. Sometimes the problem is the thing that should be holding it together is the very thing we don't understand very well. Sometimes we catch ourselves trying to make our house weather the bad weather. Sometimes we find ourselves thinking we know Jesus, and yet in the darkness we're exploring some dalliance with sin. And we're starting to wonder, what holds it together. And so to a community like that, Paul says, I'm going to preach you the gospel because you need to get the foundation in place. He's going to pull apart the pieces, and he's going to explain how they fit back together. And then at the end, he's going to tell us what difference that should make in a community that knows it. So if you got your Bible with you, flip over to the book of Romans. It's going to be in the New Testament, the back half of your Bible. It's one of the thicker books back there. And the reason it's a thick book is because it's long. Okay, good. You're paying attention. When the church was starting, one of the things that marked the early Christian community was a lack of money. And so when other people would create these beautiful long scrolls, Christians would also have to be content with just finding scraps of parchment and paper. And they would write the messages, they'd write the letters on these pieces of paper and collect them together in a stack that we eventually invented the book out of. And what happened when Paul wrote is we took his stacks, and when they put the New Testament together, instead of putting them in order, they put them in thick to thin. So the book of Romans isn't the first letter Paul wrote, but it's the longest one. And so we start with it. It's probably about the fourth one he wrote. But this is a common thing. You'll watch this happen through your New Testament. After Paul, you go to some of the other writers, and they'll go from long to short. Happens in the Old Testament, too. And this book in particular has been a very significant book in the history of the church. You may disagree with this statement, but Martin Luther in 1522 said this about the book of Romans. This letter is truly the most important piece in the New Testament. It is purest gospel. It is well worth a Christian's while not only to memorize it word for word, but also to occupy himself with it daily as though it were the daily bread of the soul. It is impossible to read or to meditate on this letter too much or too well. The more one deals with it, the more precious it becomes and the better it tastes. Whatever you think of Luther's assessment, it's an important book in your New Testament because Paul is going to explain some things that we needed explained. After Jesus had come, after we have the book of Acts, we have this guy that God uses to explain to us in a really logical way what's going on. How does this work? And in Romans chapter 1, down at verse 16, in verse 16 and 17, Paul will use those two verses to explain what he's going to do with the rest of the book of Romans. These next 16 chapters are going to be organized around the two ideas or the three pieces or four or five ideas in these two verses. I'm getting lost in the numbers here. He's going to organize the whole book around these two verses and then unpack that for the rest of the book of Romans. So we're going to spend our time this morning right here in 1:16 and 17. In verse 16, Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." I am not ashamed of the gospel. Whatever the gospel is going to be the foundation. It's going to be the thing that drives the rest of this book. It's the base that Paul is going to build upon. It is the thing that motivated Paul in verse 14. It's the thing that Paul was set aside for in verse 1. It's going to be what everything else is built on. Write that down. The gospel is the foundation. Number one, the gospel is the foundation. The word gospel in Greek is the word euangelion. It means literally good news. And in the New Testament, you would get a series of folks we would call euangelists, or in English, evangelists, who would go out to share the good news, the gospel news. It's the foundation, and sometimes it's where the weakness starts. Because we assume that we know what the gospel is, but we may not. If I asked you out at the coffee bar, what's the gospel? many of us would stumble for a minute before you could answer. The church where I grew up at as a kid, the gospel was a time in the church service every week where somebody read out of the Bible. That ain't the gospel. The gospel is a whole lot better than that. We're going to come to understand it in a moment. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation. Write that down. Number two, the gospel is the power of God for salvation. That is good news. It's not all the good news, but it's really good news. Whatever the gospel is, it's the power of God for salvation. If the gospel is the foundation, then salvation is going to be like the roof. Salvation from what exactly? I mean, sometimes we toss the words around and we talk about being saved, and now and then we forget that we were saved from something. And in the next chapter and a half, Paul's going to delineate what you're saved from. At verse 18, he will start to explain what has gone horribly wrong with humanity, and he will unpack this horrible picture of depravity, of lostness, of people who are facing the wrath of God. God will actually say in 18 and 19 that all people are unrighteous. And because of that, they've been given over to chase after their own lusts and desires. We've been handed over to destroy ourselves. And ultimately, at the end of that chapter and a half, to face the wrath of God. We're all guilty. Maybe you're not convinced. If not, you should read this book, Romans. Summer's a great time to start working your way through the book of Romans. One of my daughters wasn't convinced a number of years ago that she couldn't swim. She was absolutely convinced in her head that she could swim. And so one day when we were in a pool, I was trying to explain to her that she was wrong. And we were out where the water was over her head, and she kept arguing with me. She said, Daddy, I can swim. And I said, honey, you can't swim. You're going to sink. And she said, no, Daddy, let me go. I can swim. And so I thought, we argued, and finally I took my precious little girl, and I let her go. And she went straight to the bottom. Sank like a rock, utterly helpless. I will never forget watching her little eyes look up at me through the water. I mean, she didn't even fight. She sank until I took the power of Steve for salvation, and I reached in the water and I pulled her out, and then she understood. Then she was convinced. She had no hope without me. You were sinking. It's Romans chapter 1. You had no hope. And out of that, God brings salvation. He reaches in to your death and pulls you out. The gospel is the power of God for salvation. You had no hope without it. You may still be sinking. So pay attention this morning. Verse 16 still. It's the power of God for salvation. Two, everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. There's some good news. The power of God for salvation, the gospel, is available to everyone who believes. The Jew first and then the Greek or the Gentile, the rest of us. Not because God plays favorite, but because God said that's the way it's going to be. All the way through the Old Testament, these people who were set aside to carry his message, the gospel will come through them. Salvation will come through those people, eventually to us, to the entire earth. And all you've got to do is believe. That word believe, it's a Greek word, means, or in Greek it's pistuo, or sometimes it's a pistis, which means faith. And it's kind of fun to take the Greek now and then and put these pieces together. You don't have to memorize this for the quiz. But when you start unpacking it through the New Testament, you read that that word for believe and that word for faith and that word for trust are the same word. Sometimes a noun, sometimes a verb. It's all the same idea. Belief, faith, trust, same concept. And salvation comes through faith, right? Through belief. Write that down. That's number three. The gospel is mine through faith. But it's a tricky concept because it really is that simple. All I have to do is believe and trust the gospel. But it's not like a purchase from Amazon where I just click the button and then I sit back and wait on it to come. Once that happens, once I ask God for that, once he pulls me out of death, once I move from sinking to life, once I have salvation through the gospel, through the power of God, that affects the way I think. I'm not dying anymore. That has consequences when you start to look at your life and think, I'm not who I was. Belief may be a decision I made, but belief is a thing that's going to come to affect my whole life. That changes things. No matter what your heritage or your background, the gospel is mine through faith. But how can that be? Because my sin didn't just go away. If that was true, I don't understand why we would need this Jesus part of the story. Something must have happened to make this possible. There's a piece missing, and it's here in verse 17. For in it, in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, that it is written, the righteous will live by faith. Something had to happen to get rid of your sin. The gospel reveals the righteousness of God. Write that down. The gospel reveals the righteousness of God. The Old Testament always taught that salvation would come through faith, that the righteous would live through faith. It's in Habakkuk 2:4, the righteous shall live by faith. That's what Paul quotes here in Romans. But now, in the gospel, the way it can happen, the how, is going to be revealed. Salvation's going to come through faith, but the how is a missing piece. I get salvation because the righteousness, this quality of being upright, that quality will come through faith. Let that sink in. You get the righteousness of God. I don't have a great way to explain that. The best I can do this morning is to say, imagine that you murdered someone and you got caught. You are guilty. And you go into the courtroom and you sit in the seat and the judge takes the stand. And right before he turns to sentence you, God walks into the room. And this is God walking into the room. And he walks over to the judge. He leans down. He whispers something in your ear. And the judge looks at you and says, scoot over. And you move out of your seat, and then God goes and he sits down in your seat, and the judge says, God is innocent. You can go home. That doesn't make sense, but it's what the gospel teaches. You get the righteousness of God. That's amazing. You get it. And salvation comes to you through it, through faith, in the gospel. The righteousness of God makes you innocent in front of Him. You're not guilty, even though you were guilty. You get His righteousness. But there's still something missing. We kind of get what the gospel does. It brings you salvation through the righteousness of God through faith. We don't quite get what the gospel is yet. If you skip down to Romans 3, as Paul works his way through Romans, he does this in a number of places. He sets up what he's going to do. He does it, and then he brings us back to it on occasion. Or he'll summarize it. He'll stick it back in there. He does that at 3 verse 22. He explains what he's just been explaining. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Paul redefines some things in chapter 3. He tells you the gospel, the thing that you have faith in, the thing that your faith gives you the righteousness of God and ultimately salvation in, isn't just the gospel. The thing that is the foundation is Jesus. It's not faith in the gospel that saves you. It's faith in Jesus that saves you. It's His righteousness that brings you salvation. Jesus is the gospel. That's number 5. The gospel is Jesus. That the Old Testament always knew that the righteous would live by faith, but now in the gospel we get the means revealed. What they didn't understand in the old part of the Bible is now revealed. The thing that you have faith in, the thing that ultimately will save you, the thing that will pay for your sin, the thing that will bring you salvation is Jesus. That's the piece that was missing in the Old Testament, and now we have it, and it makes the house strong and sturdy, and Paul builds it back in for these Romans. It's your faith in Jesus. It's your faith in His work on your behalf. It's your faith in His death and resurrection, faith that the righteousness of Christ is now yours if you believe. And then belief starts to make sense. It's not an abstract idea or a concept that floats out there. It's a person. And when you believe in Him, He begins a relationship with you because He's real. He's alive. And you enter a relationship with Jesus. That's belief. That belief gives you His righteousness. His righteousness gives you salvation. You're guilty of sin and doomed to God's wrath. But Jesus loves you, and He takes you as you are if you believe. So what? What difference does that make? I mean, we could argue the salvation part's a pretty big difference, and it is. But when Paul writes to the Romans, he's not focused just on that part. There's more. This is done for you. You're sealed, and yet you still live. And with you still living, maybe God has something for you to be used for while you're here, waiting on the day when He takes you to be with Him forever. So what? Well, the answer depends. Are you ashamed of the gospel? When Paul says, I'm not ashamed, in verse 16, he's using this rhetorical device called a lie to tease. He's using understatement. It's like me saying, oh, that Dirk Nowitzki, he's not a bad ball player. Or that Congressman Wiener, he's not the most discreet of people. You take a negative and use it to mean the opposite. So when Paul says, I'm not ashamed, and you read the rest of his life, you find out Paul's really saying, I am proud of the gospel. I'm proud of Jesus. I'm not proud of me. I'm proud of Jesus. He's the thing I lead with. Jesus is the thing that holds it together. Jesus is the foundation, and he becomes Paul's proclamation. He's the base, and he becomes the flag. He is the thing that pulls all the pieces together. He's the end and the beginning. He's the part we lead with because he's the part we're built on, not on me. And the church is, sometimes we get confused about this. And once you found this, once Jesus has you, sometimes we have a tendency to forget how we got there. And I forget who I used to be. And I forget what he saved me from. And I start to look down on people who are where I was. And I think about my salvation and my righteousness and my faith. And I talk to people about that. And sometimes I forget that it's not me holding the house together. I had no hope. Jesus reached out and he rescued me. He brought salvation. He gave me his righteousness. It's my belief in him that changed everything. He did the work. And sometimes as the church, we find ourselves actually drifting away from that, and we become ashamed of the gospel. I'm embarrassed of who I used to be. I don't want to tell anybody that. I don't want to tell anybody the dark things I've struggled with. I don't want to let people know that my marriage has problems. I don't want to let people know that my kids smoked that once. I don't want to let people know that I did that with somebody I shouldn't have done that with. I don't want people to know. And so I pull away and I start to talk about my righteousness instead of talking about my Savior. And I find myself looking down on people who desperately need to know what I found out, that Jesus is the gospel, that Jesus gives hope, that Jesus caught me as I was. I've got a friend who's been a believer for about 3 or 4 months. We were talking the other night, and she had kind of a sketchy past. It's something that embarrasses her a little bit, but she's learning how to deal with that. And she said to me, "Steve, I expected people out in the world to look down on me for what I had done, but I didn't expect it in the church." Friends, that should never happen. We of all people understand that it is only because Jesus let you in that we have any hope. It's only because of Jesus, the power of God to salvation, that they've got anything in my life worth talking about. And we lead with that. We become a community that's proud of Jesus, not of what we did, and how my life is together now, and I forget, oh wait, it's not me that put it together. Jesus put my life together. That's the part I want to tell people. The gospel is the foundation. The gospel is the power of God for salvation. The gospel is mine through faith. The gospel reveals the righteousness of God. The gospel is Jesus. Be proud of what he has done and tell people, not what you are, who he is, what he did. He even rescued you. And we become a community proud of the gospel. As we close, I'd like two things to happen. First, I leave, like Scott, for a period of sabbatical rest tomorrow. So I won't be here for you to email me questions in the next few weeks. If you're sitting there and you're wondering, is it really that easy? All I got to do, trust Jesus. All I've got to do, ask Jesus for salvation. Stop. Do it. Ask him. Come down front in a moment. There'll be people down here who can pray with you. They can explain if you have questions. If you've been holding the house together on your own, you think you've got the pieces there. I know what you know, and you don't want anybody to know. You haven't really done a very good job. And you're wondering, is there something that could take this wreck of my life and put it together? He can. Decide today to do that. As that happens, I want to do something else. So if that's you, be talking to him right now. If you don't know how to talk to him, we'll teach you in a minute. It's really easy. It's really that simple. But come down front when we end. Let us pray with you. Let us walk you across that line of faith. The other thing I want to do is to celebrate the gospel. On my right, there are four roses on the stage. You know that we use the roses to symbolize new life in Christ. These four are especially meaningful to me because they all represent people in the clearing. And they're all there because we got 20-somethings at this church who were willing to be proud of the gospel and to sit down when the moment was right and explain what Jesus had done in their own lives. Two of those represent Kyle and Charlotte, friends of mine who trusted Christ at McAllister's a couple of months ago and are experiencing life when they used to know death. One of those is Justine. Justine came to Christ at a party the clearing had a few weeks ago. And the fourth one is Macy. Macy trusted Christ out in the crossing just a couple of weeks ago with some of the leaders from the clearing. Amazing stories of new life in Christ, celebrating what we know to be true. We are not ashamed of Jesus because he is the power of God for salvation for all who believe. So, Bent Tree, be proud of the gospel. Have a wonderful Sunday.